years old. Bud was 57. I'm teaching a summer camp. This guy, Arizona. And he won't stop asking me questions. How do you do this? How do you do that? And I was, after a while, after about the third day of this camp, I was like, Bud, can we, 5 minutes, can we just talk about basketball? Or something, anything. But he had this incredible thirst. He had this incredible thirst to know, not for himself, but for the young people whose lives he was touching every day. That's why he was there. And so we started talking, and then I go home. I start getting phone calls. What about this? What about this? What about this? And so before I go any further, I'm going to dispel one of the great myths in music education in this state about my relationship with Bud Helmich. I've waited over 30 years to do this. There's a couple of directors here. Because during that time, Bud started having me over to work with his kids. We had this annual thing that became known as the St. Patrick's Day Massacres. We would come over St. Patrick's Day weekend, and we would work with Bud's band all weekend with the exception of 1 hour when we played basketball. And his bands were clearly at the class of the field. And there was a rumor that if Bud didn't have folks like myself or others who came over to help him, that it wouldn't have happened. I want to tell you right now that that's a damn lie. Because every word I said in one of those get-togethers with his kids, he was sitting right there, taking notes. And the next time I came back to work with his kids, we never had to talk about that stuff again. There were new things to deal with. Like I always say to my students, I love new mistakes. I don't have time for the old ones. One of the first things I heard Bud say ever was, it doesn't matter how many times I fall down, but how many times I get up. Unfortunately, he said that during a sobriety test. But seriously, every time there was new stuff, and the band was better. There was less to do, which was great because we got to play more basketball. But then he didn't just hoard it for himself. He shared it. He called every other director he knew and said, you know, this guy's really helping me, and this guy over here is really helping me, and you might want to talk to him too, and I'm going to have him over in town. And so I started talking to those band directors. I met so many teachers here and was able to impact them and their students because of Buddy Helmich. And so the question I was asking myself when I got up at 3 a.m. Phoenix time this morning to leave from Fargo International Airport. I'm so grateful to not be wearing a coat. This is a cast. Was really who learned more from who? Because I learned that if I kept that kind of fierce hard work and that kind of fierce search for the next thing in my life, reason that I'm here tonight. You know, when we started back in 1980s, we were the Young Lions. Right? Well, now, guys like AC, they're the Young Lions. Dave Duarte, they're the Young Lions. They're not the Young Lions anymore. It's fall. It's turning November for us. But they are what they are because you were what you were. And so the reason I got up, I realized as I was being driven to the airport by my lovely wife, is just this. Think about this for a second. Let me make an analogy for you. A handful of football stadiums in the country at college campuses have been named for their coaches. But not until after they're dead. There are only two stadiums named for coaches, but the coaches are still alive. Why do we wait until people die to tell them we love them? And that's why. In a building that man should get to see his name on. And so, you know, you were noticing that you had a bunch of your alumni here? Yeah, well, there's your reason. Said, we're going to do a concert for Bud Hilditch. And I said, when and where? So,